Well, since we have come out of our own country to travel, we will go into Turkey, if you will, and see that country.
With all my heart. But now I think on it better, I will stay a while longer for the courtesan's sake. We should never get such store or such choice of mistresses. Therefore, though the honest and sober women are kept up here in Italy, the wild and wanton are let loose to take their liberty. But in Turkey, that barbarous country, all are kept close, those that will, as well as those that will not. But if they had the custom of Italy to keep up only their honest women, it were a charity. For otherwise, a man loses his time in courting after those women that will not accept of his love. For how should a man know whether women will or will not, having all sober faces, demure countenances, coy carriages, and denying words?
Yet they consent at last, for opportunity and importunity wins the chastest chief.
Faith, all that flowery rhetoric, the most observing times, the fittest opportunity, and counterfeited dyings win nothing upon a cold, icy constitution or an obstinate morality. Tis true, they may work some good effect upon an icy conscience.
From whence comes that letter?
From France, sir, I believe, from your father.
Thank you.
What news? Hath thy father sent you money?
Yes, but it is to return home, for he hath sent me word that my sister is married to a very rich, honest, and sweet-natured man, and that also he would have me return home to marry a rich heir, one that is his neighbor's daughter, for he says he wishes nothing more than to see me settled in the world before he dies, having vows to my sister and
Why, is he sick that he speaks of dying?
No, but he is old, and that's more certain of death's approach.
But is your sister married, say you?
Well, yes.
I'm sorry for it, for I thought to have married her myself.
Married? She would have had but a wild husband had she married you.
The thought of this rich heir makes thee speak most precisely, as if thou wert the most temperate man in the world, when there's none so deboised as thou art.
Prithee, hold thy tongue, for I am very discreet.
Yes, to hide thy faults, to dissemble thy passions and compass thy desires, but not to abate any of them. Well, if thy sister had not been married, I would have praised thee. But now I shall rail against thee, for losers may have leave to
talk. Why, what hopes could you have had to marry her?
Why, I was thy friend, and that was hope enough. But is thy sister so handsome as fame reports her?
Well, I do not know, for I never saw her since I was a little boy, and she a very child, I being kept strictly at school and from hence to university. But when I was to travel, I went home, but when she was at an aunt's house, 100 miles from my father's house, so as I saw her not. But I must leave off this discourse, unless you'll return into France with me.
No, Faith, I shall return without me. For I will not go so soon unless my friends had provided me with a rich heiress to welcome me home. But since they have not, I mean to stay and entertain myself and time with the plump Venetians.
Fare thee well, friend. And take heed you entertain not the disease.
Thou speakest as if thou wert a convert.
You're always at work. For what use is it? You spend more money in silk, crewel, thread, and the like than all your work is worth.
I am now making you bands.
Pray let my bands alone, for I'm sure they will be so ill-favored as I cannot wear them.
Do not condemn them before you have tried them.
You may make them, but I will never wear them.
Well, I will not make them, since you dislike it.
Lord, how ill-favored you are dressed today!
Wife, I am cleanly.
You had need be so, for if you were ill-favoredly dressed and sluttish too, it were not to be endured.
Well, husband, I will strive to be more fashionably dressed.
Like games.
I will never play at such games, but with women.
Why so?
Because they are effeminate pastimes and not manly actions. Neither will I upon fortune's favor without merit as gamesters do.
Well then, will you go to a tavern?
For what?
To drink.
I'm not thirsty.
I will have you drink until you're thirsty.
That's to drink drunk.
And that's what I desire to be.
What?
Like drunk.
So do not I, for I will not willfully make myself incapable, as I can neither be able to serve my king, country, nor friend, nor defend my honour. For when I am drunk, I can do neither. For a man drunk is weaker than a child that hath not strength to go or stand, and is worse than those that are dumb. For those that are dumb do keep silence, when those that are drunk do stutter and stammer out nonsense and make themselves fools. Besides, every coward will take courage to beat, or at least affront a man that is drunk when he dares not look askew or come near him when he is sober.
Come, come, thou shalt go. If it be but to decide your drunken quarrels and allay the wrathful vapour of Bacchus.
No, I will never decide the disputes of fools, madmen, drunkards, nor women, for fools understand no reason, madmen have lost their reason, and drunkards will hear no reason.
Well, if you will neither go to the gaming house, the tavern, nor the bawdy house, will you go and visit a sociable virgin?
Yes, I like sociable virginity very well. But pray, what are those sociable virgins that you would have me go and see?
Why, company of young ladies you meet every day to discourse and talk. To examine, censor, and judge of everybody and of everything.
'Tis pity they have not learned the rules of logic if they talk so much that they may talk sense.
I will assure you, they have voluble tongues and quick wits.
Let us go then.
Well, son, but that you are as a stranger, having not seen you in a long time. I would otherwise have shaken you spending so much since you went to travel.
Well, sir, traveling is chargeable, especially when one goes to inform himself of the fashions, manners, customs, and countries one travels through.
Well, look you, son, I have increased my family since you went from home, for your sister's beauty hath got me another son.
And I make no question that my brother's noble and gallant actions will get you another daughter.
My son, I must have you make haste and get married, that you may give me some grandchildren to uphold my posterity. For I have but you two, and your sister, I hope, will give me a grandson soon. For her maids say she's sick all morning, which is a good sign that she's breeding. Although she will not hope this, for young married wives are ashamed to confess when they hold a child. They keep it as private as if their child were unlawfully begotten.
Methinks my brother doth something resemble my wife.
No, sure, brother. So rude a made face as mine can never resemble so well a shaped face as my sister's.
I believe the Venetian ladies had a better opinion of your face in person than you deliver of yourself.
My brother can't choose but be wary, coming so long a journey today. Whether it were fit, we should leave him to pull off his boots.
My son, I think you haven't changed it much since you went to Italy, for you can hardly endure your boots to be roughly pulled off.
I am very sound, sir.
I thought so. Come thy ways, then.
Wife, I have some occasion to sell some land, and I have none that is as convenient to sell as your jointure.
All my friends will condemn me for a fool if I should part with my jointure.
Why then, you will not part with it?
I do not say so, for I think you so honest a man that if you should die before me, heaven forbid you should.
Nay, leave your prayers.
Well, husband, you shall have my jointure.
Well, if I shall, go fetch it.
Surely, husband, I deserve a kiss for it.
I cannot stay to kiss.
Madam, what will you have for your supper? For I hear my master doth not sup at home.
Anything, Joan. A little panado or water gruel.
Your ladyship's diet is not costly.
It satisfies nature as well as costly oleos or bisques, and I desire only to feed my hunger, not my gusto. For I am neither gluttonous nor rich.
No, I'll be sworn are you not.
Shall we have today?
Let us sit and rail against men.
Oh, I know young women love men too well to rail against them. Besides, men always praise the effeminate sex, and why would you rail at those that praise you?
Though men praise us to our faces, they rail at us behind our backs.
That's when you are unkind or cruel.
No, it is when we have been too kind, and they have taken the surfeit of our company.
Indeed, an overplus of kindness will soon feed a man's affection.
Wherefore I hate them, and resolve to live a single life. And so much I hate men, that if the power of Alexander and Caesar were joined into one arm, and the courage of Achilles and Hector were joined into one heart, and the wisdom of Solomon and Ulysses were joined into one brain, and the eloquence of Tully and Demosthenes were joined into one tongue, and all this in one man. And had this man the beauty of Narcissus and the youth of Adonis and would marry me, I would not marry him.
Lady, let me tell you, the youth and beauty would tempt you much.
Oh, you are deceived. For if I were to marry, I would sooner marry one that were in years, for it were better to choose grave age than fantastical youth. But howsoever, I will never marry. For those that are unmarried appear like birds, full of life and spirit. But those that are married appear like beasts, dull and heavy.
Men,
especially married men.
Men never appear like beasts, but when women make them so.
They deserve to be made beasts when you strive to make women fools. Nay, they rather think us fools than make us so. For most husbands think when their wives are good and obedient that they're simple. When I am married, I will never give my husband cause to think me simple, for I will be cross enough. That's the best way. For husbands think a cross and contradicting wife is witty, a bold and commanding wife of a heroic spirit, a subtle and crafty wife to be wise, a prodigal wife to be generous, and a false wife to be beautiful. And for those qualities, he loves her best, otherwise he hates her. Nay, the falser she is, the fonder he is of her. Nay, by your favor, wives are so enslaved that they dare not look upon any other man but their husbands.
What better object could a woman have than her husband?
By your leave, matron. One object is tiresome to view often, but variety of objects are very pleasing and delightful. For variety of objects clear the senses and refresh the mind, when only one object dulls both sense and mind, that makes married wives so sad and melancholy when they keep no other company but their husbands. And in truth, they have reason, for a husband is a surfeit to the eyes, which creates a loathing dislike unto the mind. And the truth is, variety is the life and the light of nature's ways.
And women, being the only daughters of nature and not the sons of Jove, as men are fain to be, are more pleased with variety than men are.
Which is no honour to the effeminate sex. But, as I perceive, lady, you are a rightly gotten daughter of nature and will follow the steps of your mother.
Yes, or else I shall be unnatural, which I will never be.
So, I wonder, since my sister is so handsome, that you did not marry her more to her advantage.
Why, son, I think I've married her very well for your advantage, for her beauty was her only portion, and she's married to a noble gentleman who had a very great estate.
But, sir, surely her beauty doth deserve a king, nay, an emperor, a Caesar of the world.
Oh, son, you are young, which makes you partial on your sister's side.
Have you looked at her?
Not to come near me in 2 hours, but let me sit without a fire. If you were my mistress, I should make conscience to be more diligent than you are, if I did take wages for my service, as you do.
If you do not like me, take another.
If you be weary of my service, pray change. Perchance you may get a better mistress, and I hope I shall get as careful a servant.
Curiosity, the women.
Nay, certainly, if women were employed in the affairs of state, the world would live more happily.
So they were employed in those things or business that were proper for their strength and capacity.
Let me tell you, ladies, women have no more capacity than what is as thin as a cobweb lawn, which every eye may see through, even those that are weak.
Oh, well, I'm blind. We are not fools. We're capable of knowledge. We only want education and experience to make us as wise as men.
But women are incapable of public employment.
Some, we will grant, are. But so are some men. For some are neither made by heaven nor education fit to be statesmen. And education is the chief, for lawyers and divines can never be good statesmen. They are too learned to be wise. They may be good orators, but never subtle counselors. They're better disputers than contrivers. They're fitter for faction than for reformation. The one makes quarrels or upholds them. The other raises doubts. But good statesmen are bred in courts, camps, and cities, not in schools and closets and bars and pulpits. And women are bred in courts and cities. They only want the camp to give them the perfect state breeding.
Certainly, if we had that breeding and did govern, we should govern the world better than it is.
Yes, for it cannot be governed worse than it is.
For the whole world is together by the ears, all up in walls of blood, which shows there is a general defect in the rulers and governors thereof.
Indeed, the state councillors in this age have more formality than policy, and princes more plausible words than rewardable deeds, in so far as the elect fiddlers that play artificially and skillfully, yet it is but a sound which they make, and not real presences.
This, strange ladies, to hear how you talk without knowledge. Neither is it fit for young ladies as you are to talk of state matters. Leave this discourse to the autumnal of your sex, or old court ladies, who take upon them they know everything, although they understand nothing But your discourses should be of balls, masks, plays, and such like recreations, fit for your youth and beauties.
What's the reason you turn away Nan?
Wife, she turns away me, for she's more willing to be gone than I to have her go.
It is a strange humour in you, as never to be pleased, for you're always quarrelling with your servants.
Truly, I do not remember that I ever had a dispute or quarrel with any servant since I was your wife, before this with your maid Nan. And to prove it is that I do not speak many words in a whole day.
Those you speak, it seems, are sharp.
Let it be as you say, for I will not contradict you.
Well then, take notice. I will not have Nan turned away.
I am glad she pleases you so well, and sorry I can please you no better.
She is very handsome, extreme handsome, beyond all the women that ever nature made. And that she were not my sister.
I doubt I've surprised you with my son coming in. Before you start.
Your beauty, sister, will not only surprise but astonish any man that looks thereon.
You have used yourself so much in dissembling courtships since you went to Italy that you cannot forbear but to use them to your own sister. But pray, leave off that unnecessary civility and let us talk familiarly, as brothers and sisters used to do.
With all my heart, as familiarly as you please.
Pray, brother, tell me, if the women of Italy be handsome, and what fashion they have, and how they are behaved.
To tell you in short, they are so artified as a man cannot tell whether they are naturally handsome or not. As for their behavior, they are very modest, brave and ceremonious in public and in private, confident, kind and free, after a humble and insinuating manner. They are bred to all virtuosa, especially to dance, sing and play on musical instruments. They are naturally crafty, deceitful, false, covetous, luxurious, and amorous. They love their pleasures better than heaven. But this relation is only of the courtesans. As for those that are kept honest, I can give little or no account, for they are so enclosed with locks and bolts and only look through a jealousy, so as a stranger cannot obtain a sight, much less an acquaintance.
Then they have not that same liberty we French women have?
No.
Why? Are they afraid they would all turn courtesans if they should be left to themselves?
The men are jealous and will not put it to the trial, for though they are all merchants, even the princes themselves, yet they will not venture their wives.
I would not live there for the world. For to be so restrained, for it is said the men are so jealous of their wives as they are of their brothers, fathers, and sons.
They are so, for they are wise, and know nature made all in common, and to a general use. For particular laws were made by man, not by nature.
They were made by the gods, brother.
What gods, sister? Old men with long beards.
Fine, fine! Have you grown so wild in Italy as France has done? We'll hardly be able to reclaim you. But I hope, when you are married, you will be reformed and grow sober.
Why, sister, have you become more sober or reformed since you are married?
Oh, I was never wild nor wanton, but always modest and honest.
Faith, sister, methinks you might have been married more to your advantage than you are, had not my father been so hasty in marrying you so young.
Why do you say so, brother? When the man I'm married to is so worthy a person as I do not merit him, neither would I change it for the world!
Hey, sister, Be not angry, for 'tis my extreme love, having no more sisters but you, that makes me speak.
Pretty brother, do not think me angry, for I believe it proceeds from love, and that it is your affection that makes you so ambitious for me.
No, sister, that I love you so well, and so much, as 'tis a torment to be out of your company.
Thank you, brother. And know that I never desire to be in any other company than my husband, my father, and brother. Nay, any other company is troublesome.
My discourse is at their service.
Methinks, ladies, your wits run nimbly, fly high, and spread far. Wherefore make a witty match, or a match of eloquence?
With all my heart. For in the combat of eloquence I shall do like to a valiant man in a battle. For though he wins not the victory, yet he proves not a coward. So though I should not get the victory of wit or eloquence, yet I shall not prove myself a fool.
I will make no such match, for though I have read some very few books, yet I have not studied logic, nor rhetoric. To place and set words in order. And for though I have read history and such like books, yet I have not got their speeches by heart, nor part of them, as a part of one oration and of another oration, and of three or four, to make up a narration of my own, as all orators do nowadays. Yet it would be condemned if the speaker is not learned, and their speeches express not learning.
Now you talk of speeches and orations, it seems very strange to me to read the speeches that chronologers put down to be truly related as from now to those that spoke them, especially such as are spoken extempore and on a sudden, but more especially, those that are spoken in mutinies and to a tumultuous multitude, wherein is nothing but destruction, both in the speakers and hearers. Frights and fears in opposers and assaulters. As, for example, when Tacitus set down the speeches of some persons at such times, when and where everyone was in such fears and disorders as there seemed to be not any one person that could have the leisure, time, rest, or silence to get those speeches by heart, to bear them away in their memory, or to write them down.
But the speeches that Thucydides sets down may be better credited, because most of them were premeditated and soberly, orderly, and quietly delivered, which might more easily be noted and exactly taken to deliver to posterity.
Another thing is how Tacitus could come to know the private speeches betwixt man and man, as friend and friend, brother and brother. Nay, not only so, but he hath writ the thoughts of some commanders and others.
Lady, let me tell you, you must not be so strict in history as to have every word true. For it is a good history if the sense, matter, manner, form and actions be true. As, for example, let's say a man should be presented all naked. Is he less a man for being naked? Or is he more a man for being clothed? Or for being clothed after another fashion than his own? So, history is not the less true if the sense, matter, actions, occasions, and forms and like be related, although every word be not expressed as they were. Thus, the body and subject of those speeches might be true, only the dress is new.
Well, let me tell you that chronologists do not only new dress truth, but falsify her, as may be seen in our later chronologers, such writers as Cameron and the like. For he have writ not only partially, but falsely. For some families of ancient descent, Camden have not mentioned. Some he have mentioned falsely, and some he have not writ about at all.
I observed one error in his writing. That is, when he mentions such places and houses, he says, the ancient situation of such a worthy family. When, to my knowledge, most of those families owned those houses someone descent before, but he leaves those ancient families unmentioned.
Perchance he thought it fit that those families that were so ill husbands, or had so ill fortunes as they were forced to sell their ancient inheritance, that their memory shall be buried in their ruins.
What say you of the chronology of the gods and gallant heroes, which was Homer?
I say he was a better poet than a historian.
Why, Homer's works are only a poetical history, which is a Romans. For Romans writers heighten natural actions beyond natural power, as to describe by their wit unnatural things, yet to make them seem or sound probable.
Nay, faith, impossible things can never be described to be probable.
I'm sure Homer was out when he makes them miscall one another, giving one another ill names when they met to fight, such as dog and the like. When in these our days, when noble persons meet to fight, they bring compliments in their mouths and death in their hands, so as they strive as much in civility as courage. Well, indeed, true valour is civil.
If you condemn Homer for making men to speak so, you may condemn him much more for making the gods to speak after that manner.
Well, the truth is, Homer, as excellent a poet as he is famed to be, yet he has not fitted his terms of language proper to those persons he makes to speak, nor the behaviours of those persons he describes proper to their qualities nor dignities. For as you say, he not only makes the gods speak like mortals, but like rude-bred, ill-natured clowns, and to behave themselves like rude, barbarous, brutish, and cruel men, when he should have made the gods to have spoken in the most eloquentest of humane languages, and after the most elegant manner.
For my part, I can never read Homer upon a full stomach, for if I do, I'm sick to hear the broiled roasts and boiled meats.
They had meat fit for soldiers, not ladies.
It was a sign he had excellent stomachs in Homer's days.
It was a sign Homer had a good hungry stomach himself.
It was a sign that those persons in those days were hospitable and noble entertainers. But in these times, even the noblest sort are too curious or delicate.
I have observed that one pen may blur a reputation, but one pen will hardly glorify a reputation.
No, for to glorify requires many pens and witnesses, and all little enough.
It is neither here nor there for that. For have not some writers spoke well of Nero and have strived to glorify him, who was the wickedest of all emperors? And have not some writers done the like for Claudius, who was the foolishest of all emperors? And yet, they were never the more esteemed in the house of fame. And have not some writers writ ill and have endeavored to blot and blur the renounce of Julius Caesar, Augustus Caesar, and of Alexander? And yet, they were never the worst esteemed in the house of fame. But heroic actions and wise governors force pens, although pens cannot force swords.
By a favour, but pens and prints do force swords sometimes, nay, for the most part. For do not books of controversies or engravings or printed laws make enemies, and such enemies as to pursue with fire and sword to death?
Well, I do not believe it was the glory conquering the most part of the world which made Alexander and Caesar to be so much reverenced, admired, and renowned by those following ages, but that their heroic actions were seconded with their generous deeds.
You say true, and as there have been none so heroical since their deaths, there have been none so generous.
By your leave, lady, you are unlearned. Otherwise, you would find that there have been princes since their times as heroical and generous as they were.
No, no, there have been none that have so noble souls as they have.
Indeed. Princes are not so severe,
nor do they carry that state and majesty as those in former times, for they neglect that ceremony, which ceremony makes them as gods and gives them a divine splendor. For the truth is, ceremony makes them as gods, when the wonder of makes them appear as ordinary men.
It must needs, for when princes throw off ceremony, they throw off royalty, for ceremony makes a king like a god.
Then if I were a king or had royal power, I would make such ceremonies as I would be deified, and so worshipped, adored, and prayed to whilst I lived.
So would I, rather than to be prayed to or sainted when I were dead.
My ceremony will make you as a god, both alive and dead. When without ceremony, you will not be so much as sainted.
Come, come, ladies, you talk like young ladies, you know not what.
For she is more in my master's chambers than she is in yours. But to let her triumph and domineer and command all as chief mistress, not just the servants, but all yourself as you have come to be at her allowance.
How should I help it?
Well, if it were me, I would wring my husband such appeal that I would make him weary of his wench or his life.
Yes, so I may disquiet myself, but not mend my husband, for men that love variety are not to be altered, neither with compliance or crossness.
'Tis true if he did or would love variety, but well, he only loves Nan, a wench, which have neither the wit, beauty, nor good nature of your ladyship.
I thank you, Joan, for your commendation.
But many times a good-natured wife makes an ill-natured husband.
That's when men are fools and want the wit and judgment to value.
Why, then my master is one. But why will you be so good as to spoil him? For in my conscience, if you were worse, he would be better.
The reason is that self-love hath the first place, and therefore I will not dishonor myself to mend or reform my husband. For everyone is only to give account to heaven and to the world of their own actions, and not of any other's actions, unless it be for witness.
So I perceive you will not turn away this wench?
It is not in my power.
Oh, but try whether it be or not.
No, I will not venture in it, lest I and my maid should be the public discourse of the town.
Why, if she should have the better, yet the town would pity you, condemn my master, and well, that would be some comfort.
No, truly. For I would rather be buried in silent misery and to be forgotten of mankind than to live, to be pitied.
Then I would make him a scorn to all the world by cuckolding him.
Heaven forbid that I should stain that which gave me a reputation, my birth and family, or defame myself, or trouble my conscience for turning a whore for revenge.
Well, if you had seen what I did see, you would hate me so you would study a revenge.
What was that?
Why, when you came into my master's chamber when he was sick from the French box, I think you chanced to taste the broth that sat upon the table, and, well, when you were gone, he commanded Nan to fling out the broth which you had tasted and put fresh into the pot to drink.
That's nothing, for many cannot endure to have their pottage blown upon.
It was not so with him, for before he tasted the broth, Nan blew it and blew it and tasted it again and again, and another time to try the heat, and another time to see if it was salt enough, and well, he seemed to like that better. Besides, he was never quiet while you were in the chamber. Until you went out, he snapped you up at every word, and if you dared but touch anything, he bid you let it alone. And finally, when he bid you to go to your own chamber, well, he seemed pleased when you were gone.
Alas, those that are sick are always froward and peevish, but prithee, Joan, have more charity to judge for the best, and have less passion for me.
Ladies, what will you discourse of today?
Of nature.
No, that is too vast a subject to be discoursed of.
For the theme being infinite, your discourse will have no end.
You are mistaken, for nature lives in a quiet mind, feeds in a generous heart, dresses in a poetical head, and sleeps in a dull understanding.
Nature's flowers are poets' fancies, and nature's gardens are poetical hills.
Pray, leave her in her garden and talk of something else.
Then let us talk of thoughts, for thoughts are the children of the mind, begot betwixt the soul and senses.
And thoughts are several companions, and like courtly servitors, do lead and usher the mind into several places.
Pray, stay the discourse of thoughts, for it's a dull discourse. Then let us talk of reason.
Why should we talk of reason when there are so many seeming reasons as the right cannot be known?
Seeming reasons are like seducing flatterers. Persuade us truth when all is false, they say. Then let us talk of justice.
Justice to the generality have a broad full face, and to particular it have a quarter and a half quarter face, and to some particulars it veils it all over. Wherefore to talk of justice? Is it talk blindfold?
Then let us talk of bashfulness.
What? Should we talk of our own disgrace?
A grace, you mean, lady?
Oh, surely. A distempered countenance and a distorted face can be no grace.
Well then, let us talk of the passion.
Well, it is easier to talk of them than to conquer and govern them. Although it is easier to conquer the perturbed passions of the mind than the unruly appetites of the body. For the body is grosser than the soul, and so the appetites are stronger than the passions.
Let us talk of gifts. There are no gifts worth the talking of, but natural gifts as beauty, wit, good nature, and the like.
Then let us talk of wit. That is a natural gift.
Nature gives wit to very few. For some, there are counted wits of but wit legions that suck and swell with wit of other men. And when they're overgorged, they spew it out again. But since we are by nature not so endued, wit is not a subject fit to be pursued by us.
Then let us talk of beauty.
Well, those that have it take greater pleasure in fame than in possession, for they care not so much to talk of it as to hear the praises of it.
Come, ladies, let us go, for I perceive your wits can settle upon no one subject this day.
Spirit moves with the disordered taste. My thoughts tumultuously together throng, striving to pull down reason from his throne and banish conscience from the soul.
What, son? Love alike already, before you have even seen your mistress? Her father, I am agreed. There is nothing wanting but the priest and ceremony, and all is done.
Well, sir, there are our affections wanting, for we never saw one another, wherefore it is not known whether we will affect or not.
I hope you're not so disobedient to dispute your father's will.
And I hope, sir, that you will not be so unkind as to force me to marry one I cannot love.
Not love? Why, she's the richest heiress in the kingdom.
I am not covetous, sir. I'd rather please my fancy than increase my estate.
Your fancy! Let me tell you that your fancy is a fool, and if you do not obey my will, I will disinherit you.
I fear not poverty.
Not fear you not a father's curse?
Yes, sir, that I do.
Why then? You sure you shall have it if you refuse her?
Pray, give me some time to consider of it.
Pray do, and consider wisely you had best.
I doubt my lady will die.
I fear so, for when the doctor took her pulse, he shook his head, which was an ill sign.
It was a high fever she is in.
The doctor says a high continual fever.
She's a fine young lady. 'Tis a pity she should die.
My master puts on a sad face, but me think his sadness doth not appear for a three die.
Gives life and proves this urn.
A lowering sky and sunny rays is like a commendation with dispraise, or like to cypress bound to bays, or like to tears on wedding days.
Flattering tongue and a false heart, kind embrace which makes me start, a beauteous form, a soul that's evil, is like an angel but a devil. A woman old to have an amorous passion, Puritan in a fantastic fashion, a formal statesman which dances and skips about, a bold fellow which is of countenance at.
To laugh and cry, to mingle smiles and tears, is like to hopes and doubts and joys and fears, as several passions mixes in one mind, so several postures in one face may find.
To love and hate both at one time, and in one person both to join, to love the man but hate the crime, is like to sugar put to brine.
Ladies, you had better tell some tales to pass your time with, for your rhymes are not full of wit enough to be delightfully sociable.
Agreed. Let us tell some tales.
Once upon a time, honor made love to virtue. Ooh. A gallant and heroic lord he was, and she a sweet, modest, and beautiful lady. A naked truth was the confidant to them both, which carried and brought love messages and presents to and from each other.
Out upon beastly truth, for if she goeth naked, I dare say she is a wanton wench. And virtue's little better than herself, if she keeps her company, or can behold her without winking. And I shall shrewdly suspect you ladies to be like her, if you discourse of her, but more, if you have any acquaintance with her. But since you are so wild and wanton as to talk of naked truth, I will leave you to your scurrilous discourse, for I am ashamed to be in your company and to hear you speak such ribaldry. Oh fie, naked truth, Jove, to keep me from naked truth and also from her sly companion, virtue. Out upon them both.
Now you have seen your mistress, brother. Tell me how you like her.
It were rudeness to your sex if I should say I dislike any woman.
Surely you cannot dislike her, for
she's handsome, well-behaved,
well-bred, a great estate, and of a good fame and family.
May she have a husband answerable.
Why, she will when she marries you.
I cannot equal her virtues nor merit her beauty, wherefore I will not injure her with marriage.
Well, are you not married?
No.
I hope you speak not in earnest.
Truth, sister, I do not jest.
Prithee, do not tell my father so. For if you do, he will be in such a fury there will be no pacifying him.
If you desire it, I will not.
First, reason with yourself, and see if you can persuade your affections.
Affections? Sister, affections can neither be persuaded either from or to, for if they could, I would employ all the rhetoric I have to persuade them. Sister?
Where is your brother?
He is even now gone from hence.
A chance. He's not gone to his mistress.
I know not, sir, but he looked as if he were not well.
Not well? He's a foolish young man, and one that hath had his liberty so long as he hates to be tied in wedlock's bonds. But how a gold rattled him.
Pray, sir! Persuade him by degrees, and be not too violent at first with him.
The mess, girl. It's me good counsel.
I will temper him gently.
Servants, but with the greatest civility, as to say, go do such a thing, or pray do such a one, or give or fetch me such or such a thing. All her servants loved her so well as they would have laid down their lives in her sake, unless it were her maid, Nan.
Well, I'll say no more, but pray God Nan hath not given her a Spanish fig.
Why, if she did, there's none of us know so much as could come as witnesses against her.
It is a rather strange negligence that you two sit prating here and do not go to have to lay my lady for.
My master weeps? I did not know he loved my lady so well.
That is nothing, for most will love the dead better than the living. And many will hate a friend when they are living and love them when they are dead.
Brother, why weep you?
immortality spouts tears through my eyes to quench love's raging fire that's in my heart. But 'twill not do. The more I strive with greater fury than it burn.
Brother, if you be in love, she must be a cruel woman that will deny you. For pure and virtuous love softens the hardest hearts and melts them into pity.
Would I were turned to stone and made a marble tomb wherein lies nothing but cold death, rather than live tormented thus.
Heaven keep my fears from proving true.
So much as to marry my maid.
Faith, that is some kindness in husbands, that they will remember their wives when they are dead, yet they forget them whilst they live.
A good wife cannot be forgotten, neither dead nor alive.
By your favour, sir, a bad wife will remain longest in the memory of her husband because she vexed him most.
In my conscience, lady, you will make a good wife.
Well, if you think so, you had best try.
Shall I be accepted, lady?
I know no reason I should refuse, sir, for report says you have a great estate, and I see you are a handsome man. And as for your disposition and nature, let it be as bad as it can be. Mine shall match it.
My nature loves a free spirit.
And mine loves no restraint.
Lady, for this time I shall kiss your hand. And if you will give me leave, I shall visit you at your lodging.
You shall be welcome, sir. Did I not tell you I should have him? Jesting and raillery doth not always make up a match. Well, well, ladies, God be with you, for I must go home and provide for my wedding, for I perceive it will be done on a sudden, for widowers are more hasty to marry than bachelors, and widows than maids.
Stay, lady, you must first get the goodwill of your parents.
Wait! Bring us to your wedding!
Offended? Sisters should not be so unnatural as to be weary of a brother's company or angry at their grief, but rather strive to ease the sorrow of their hearts than load on more with their unkindness.
Heaven knows, brother, if my life could ease your grief, I would willingly yield it up to death.
God! commanding nature to give us appetites, then starve us with your laws. Decree our ruin and our fall. Create us only to be tormented.
I dare not ask his grief or search his heart, for fear that I should find which I would not know.
Chamber, all things necessary.
Let her command one of her own maids, for I am none of her servant.
Why, whose servant are you?
My master's, who hired me and pays me my wages. I never saw her nor she me.
All my master's servants are my ladies. Man and wife divide not their servants, as to say, those are mine, these are yours.
Why, I'm sure in my other ladies' type, all the masters, all the servants were my master's. And none, my ladies, for she had not the power to take or turn away anyone.
That was a pity, for she was both virtuous and wise, besides beautiful and well-bred, rich and honorably born, and of a sweet disposition. But, to say this young lady has such a spirit as she will share in the rule and government.
Yes, yes, for a little while, as long as honeymoon lasts, I dare warrant you, she shall reign no rule no longer.
Come, my friends and fellow servants, let's everyone about our several affairs.
Fall to the ground at your feet, crave mercy. It is not life they ask, but love that they would have.
Why, so you have. For I vow to heaven, I love you more than the ambitious man loves power, or the vainglorious man loves fame. Yes. Better than the body loves health, or the life loves peace.
Yet still you love me not as I would have you love.
Why, how would you have me love?
As husbands love their wives, and wives their husbands.
Why, so I do.
And will you lie with me?
Would you have me commit incest?
Oh, sister, follow not those foolish binding laws that frozen men have made, but follow nature's laws, whose freedom gives a liberty to all.
Heaven bless your soul, for surely you are possessed by some wicked spirit that uses not to wander amongst men.
Sister, be not deceived with empty words and vainer tales made only at the first to keep the ignorant vulgar sort in awe, whose faith, like to their greedy appetites, take whatsoever is offered, cares of bad or ill to their stomachs they never consider, but think all good they can get down. So whatsoever they hear, they think 'tis true, although they have had no reason or possibility for it.
But
but learned and knowing. Wise and judicious men, holy and good men. Know this, you ask, is wicked.
They do not know it, but they believe as they are taught from what is taught men in their childhood grows strong in their manhood, and so as they grow in years, so grow they up in superstition. Thus, wise men are deceived and cozened by length of time, taking an old forgotten deed to be a true sealed bond before dear sister. Your principles are false, wherefore your doctrine cannot be true.
Heaven hath taught our doctrine, wherefore we cannot err.
Heaven considers us no more than beasts that freely live together.
That I should see my only brother turn from man to beast.
I'm glad the ice is broke. And that her fury rages not like fire. Not a good one, sweet.
Fie upon it! I hate such an old-fashioned house. So pray pull it down and build another more fashionable, as if there may be a bell view and pergolas around the outside of the house. Also, arched gates, pillars and pilasters, and carved frontispieces with antique imagery. Also, I would have all the lower rooms vaulted and the upper rooms flat-roofed, painted, and gilded, and the planches checkered and inlaid with silver. Then I would have the staircase to be large and winding, and the steps to be broad and low as shallow. Then also fountains and waterworks, and those waterworks to imitate those birds in winter that only sing in summer.
But this will cost a great sum of money, wife.
That's true, husband. But what use is money unless to spend?
But it ought to be spent prudently.
Prudently, say you. Prudence and temperance are the executioners of delight and the murderers of pleasure. Wherefore I hate them, as also this covetous humor of yours.
Marry, sir, here's a lady indeed, for she talks of tearing down this house before she has truly seen it, and of building up another.
Well, you have my opinion. The old servants must go down as well as the old house.
I'm afraid so, for she looked very scornfully upon us, and spoke not one word, neither good nor bad to us.
Well, come, let us go about our employments, and please as long as we can, and when we can no longer please, we must seek other services.
Bury not my youth in death before the natural time.
Tis better you should die and in a grave be laid than live to damn your soul.
To kill myself will be as bad a crime.
No, for death anyway is more honorable than such a life as you would live.
find no man so exact as I would have a husband to be. For first, I would not have a very tall man, for he would always appear to me like the like his soul and body were mismatched, as to have a pygmy soul and a giantly body.
Perchance his soul is answerable to his body.
Then I would not have a very lean man, for he would always appear to me like the picture of death, had he but a siphon hourglass in his hand. And though we are told to have always death in our minds, to remember our end, yet I would not have death always before my eyes and be afraid of my end. But to have a very lean husband would be to have death in my arms as much as in my eyes, and my bed would be as my grave.
Your bed would be a warm grave.
My sister, though death is cold, the grave is hot, for the earth have heat, though death have none.
What say you to a fat man?
I say a fat man is a bedfellow only for the winter, not for the summer. And I would have such a man as husband as may be my nightly companion all year round.
I hope you would not make your husband so constant a bedfellow as to always lie together in one bed.
Why not?
Because a woman's stomach or belly may ache, which may make wind work. And the rumbling winds may decrease love, and so your husband may dislike you. And dislike in time may make him unfaithful.
Well, by your favour, it increases matrimonial love. 'Tis true, it may decrease amorous love. But the more amorous love increases, the more danger a woman is in. For that kind of love, even to wives, is dangerous, as that kind of love takes delight to progress about, when matrimonial love is constant and considers nature as it is. Besides, a good husband would not dislike that in me, which he is subject to himself. But howsoever, I will never marry. Unless I can find such a man as is attended by virtue, directed by truth, instructed by age on honest grounds and honourable principles. A man that would neither dislike me nor I him. But the more we are together, the better we shall love, and live as a married pair ought to live, and not as dissembling lovers, as most married couples do.
Takes upon you to govern and to be mistress in this house?
Well, I do. But that I did in other ladies' time.
Let me tell you, you shall not do so in my time. Nay, you shall have no doings. Wherefore, get out of the house.
I will not go.
No. But you shall. Here, take this wench and put her out of the gates.
Touch me! And now you dare shall have one to defend me.
I defy your champion.
What? You fail, will you force her? Set her down!
I did no more than what I commanded.
Sir? Who commanded you?
My lady, sir, commanded me to carry her out the gates.
Pray, let her alone until I've spoke with my wife.
I shall, sir.
What's the matter now?
Only my lady's dislike of my person, which could not be through any neglect of my service, of faithful duty, or humble diligence, but through a passionate humour, because she have heard you are pleased heretofore to favour me.
But now we are very honest, now.
Yes, the more unkind men you are, to win a young maid for love, and then to turn her away in disgrace.
I do not turn you away.
Yes, but you do, if you suffer my lady to turn me away.
How should I help that? For she hath such a strong spirit as not to be controlled.
Oh, sir, if you bridle her, you may guide her as you will.
How should I bridle her?
Well, put her to her allowance and take the government of your family out of her hands, as you did to your former lady.
My other wife was born with a quiet, obedient nature, and this one with a high and turbulent nature. And if I were to cross her high working spirit, she would grow mad.
Well, then you would have a good excuse to tie up.
Oh, her friends would never suffer me. Besides, the whole world would condemn me and account me a tyrant.
Well, it is better to be accounted a tyrant than a fool.
Oh no, for men are ought to be sweet and gentle natured to the effeminate sex.
I see by you that the worse that men are used, the better husbands they make. For you were both unkind and cruel to your former lady. Neither would you give, or at least not think of such arguments for her.
Will you rebuke me for that which you persuaded me unto, by dispraising your lady unto me?
Alas, sir, I was so fond of your company that I was jealous even of my lady. And love is to be pardoned. Wherefore, dear sir, tell me not to wait. For heaven knows, I desire to live no longer when I can have your favor. And I wish I were blind if I might not be, for I may see you. And my heart leaps for joy whensoever I hear your voice. Wherefore, good sir, for love's sake, pity me.
Well, I will speak to my wife for you.
If I can get my master to dance once, to kiss me again, which I shall be industrious for, I will be revenged of this domineering lady. I hope I shall be too crafty for her.
Reason can conquer my evil desires, or else I'll die.
Heaven pours a holy balsam into your festered soul.
Wife? I come an humble petitioner to you in the behalf of Nan. She hath been a servant here ever since I was first married to my other wife.
No, no, husband. You will have none of your whores in the house where I live. If you must have whores, go seek them abroad.
Prithee, wife, let not your jealous passion turn away a good servant.
And you rather please your servant? A whore? Or me?
Why, you?
Then turn her away!
But surely, wife, you will let me have so much power as to keep an old servant?
No, husband. If your old servant be a young, lusty witch.
But I have passed my word that she shall stay.
And I have sworn an oath that she shall go away.
But my word must be kept, wherefore she shall not go away.
I say she shall go away, nay, more. I will have her whipped at the end of a cart and sent out of doors.
As I am master, I shall command that none shall touch her. And let me see who dares touch her.
Who dares touch her? Why, I can hire poor fellows for money, not only to whip her, but murder you.
Are you so free with my estate? I will discharge you of that office of keeping my money.
Well, if you do, I have youth and beauty that will hire me revengers and get me champions.
Will you so?
Yes, for anything rather than what my will. And no, I perfectly hate you for taking my maid's part against me.
Prithee, wife, be not choleric. For I said all this but to try thee.
You shall prove me, husband, before I have done.
Should I divulge my brother's crimes? Which are such crimes as will put the mark of black infamy upon my family and race forever? Or should I let vice run without restraint? Or should I prove false to my husband's bed to save my brother's life? Or should I damn my soul and his to satisfy his wild desires? No. We will both die to save our soul and keep our honors clear.
The more I struggle with my affections, the weaker do I grow for to resist. If gods had any power, they sure would give me strength. Or were they just, they would exact no more than I can pay. And if they cannot help, or will not help me, furies, rise up from the infernal deep. Lend my actions aid. Devils, assist me so that I may learn you to be more evil than you are, and then, when all my black, horrid designs are fully finished, then take my soul, which is the quintessence of wickedness, and squeeze some venom forth upon the world that may infect mankind with plagues of sins. There are multitudes will bury mine, or count me as a saint and offer at my shrine.
You must be contented, for you must be gone, for your lady will not suffer you to be in the house.
But will you visit me, if we should live close to each other at the next town?
No, for that will cause a parting betwixt my wife and me, which I would not have for all the world. Wherefore, Nan, God be with you.
May your house be your hell, and your wife be your devil!
Trade in vanities and see if they will give me credit in case my husband should restrain his purse for me, and tell them that they may make my husband pay for my debts. But also, I will have you take me a fine house in the city, for I intend to live there and not in this dull place where I see nobody but my husband, who spends his time sneaking in after his maid's tails, having no other employment. Besides, solitariness begets suspicion, and suspicion begets melancholy, and melancholy jealousy. so that my husband grows amorous with idleness and jealous with melancholy. Thus, he hath the pleasure of variety, and I the pain of jealousy. Wherefore, be you industrious as to obey my command.
I shall, madam.
I hear, wife, that you are going to the metropolitan city?
Yes, for I find myself much troubled with the spleen, so I go to try if I can be cured.
Why will the city cure the spleen?
Yes, for it is the only remedy, for melancholy must be diverted with divertisements. Besides, there are the best physicians.
I will send for some of the best and most famous physicians from thence, if you will stay.
Nay, by your favour, for they will exact so much upon your importance as they will cost more money than their journey is worth.
But, wife, it is my delight and profit to live in the country. Besides, I hate the city.
And I hate the country.
But every good wife ought to conform herself to her husband's humours and wills.
But, husband, I profess myself no good wife. Wherefore, we'll follow my own humour.
I find there's no crossing her. She will have her will.
I have. You shall have, husband. But what will my brother say if his Bob should lose the match?
I asked him that question, and he answered that if he lost, he would knock his Barb's brains out of his head.
Where's my brother?
Why, he's with your father, and such a good companion he is today, and so merry. As your father is so fond of his company, insomuch as he hangs about his neck as a new married wife. But I conceive the chief reason is that your brother seems to consent to marry the lady Amour.
I'm happy with that, with all my heart.
But he says if he doth marry her, it must be by your persuasions.
He will want no persuading if I can persuade.
Come, wife, will you give me some ribbons?
Yes. And I will go fetch them.
Nay, wife. I will go along with you.
My master looks so lean and pale, I doubt he is in a consumption.
Faith, he takes something to heart, whatsoever it is.
I doubt he is jealous.
Well, he hath reason, for if my lady doth not cuckold him, she gives the world cause to think she doth, for she is never without her gallants.
There's a great difference betwixt our lady that is dead and this.
Is my wife come home yet?
No. Sir.
I think it be about 12 of the clock.
It is past one, sir.
If it be so late, I will sit up no longer watching for my wife's coming home, but I will go to bed. For I'm not very well.
You do not look well, sir.
Indeed, I'm very sick.
So soon, hath not your Barb run the race?
No.
What makes you here then?
To see you.
To see me? Why, I shall give you no thanks because you left my husband behind you.
I do not come for your thanks. I come to please myself.
Prithee, brother, get thee gone, for your face does not appear as honest as it uses to do.
I do not know how my face doth appear, but my heart is as it was, your faithful lover.
Heaven forbid you should relapse into your old disease.
Let me tell you, sister, I am as I was, and was as I am, that is, for since I saw you, since I came from travel, I have been in love with you, and must enjoy you. If you will embrace my love with a free consent, so, if not, I'll force you to it.
Heaven will never suffer it, but cleave to earth and swallow you alive.
I care not, so you be in my arms. But we'll first try heaven's power and struggle with the tears.
Melancholy, to sit up all night at cards and to lose £500 in one sitting.
Oh yes, for the doctors say there is nothing better than good company to employ the thoughts with outward objects. Otherwise the thoughts feed too much upon the body. Besides, they say that exercise is excellent good to open obstruction and to disperse melancholy vapour. And the doctors say there is no exercise better than dancing, because there are great company meet together, which adds pleasure to the labour.
My other wife did not do this.
Wherefore she died in youth with melancholy. But I mean to live while I'm old, if mirth and good company will keep me alive. And no, I'm not so kind-hearted to spare your purse. Or please your humour.
Company, although in death and in the silent grave, where no loves make no passion known.
This welcome news, for if death comes not by your hand, my hand shall give a passage on to life.
There is none so fit to act the part, as I was so full of sin, nothing now but murder to make a measure.
Death, thou art my grief's reproof. That wilt unlade my soul from heavy thought that miserable life grows on and sinks me to the ground. Brother, farewell. And may your crimes be buried in my grave and your shame in mine. Never know.
She is dead. My mind is at rest, for I know none will enjoy her after me. But I will follow thee. I come, my mistress, wife, and sister, all in one.
Wife, you're very unkind that you will not come see me now that I'm sick, nor so much as send to know how I do.
I'm loath to trouble you with unnecessary visits or impertinent questions.
Is it unnecessary or impertinent to come see your husband when he's sick, nor so much as ask how he doth?
Yes, if the questions or visits can do them no good. But God be with you, for I must go home. For I must be gone, of course.
What, already?
Yes, for I'm afraid I've stayed too long, for I've appointed a meeting, and it will be a dishonour for me to break my word.
It will be more dishonour to be dancing when your husband is dying, lady.
What, will you teach me go to the boys and girls and not me?
Let her go, friend. Oh, her anger will disturb me.
I know not her anger doth you, but her neglect of you doth disturb me. And for my part, I wonder how you suffer her.
Alas, how shall I help or remedy it? But heaven is just and punishes me for the neglect I used towards my first wife, who was so virtuous and kind.
She was a sweet lady indeed.
Oh, she was. But I... devil as I was to use her as I did, making her a slave unto my whore and frowns, conjecturing all her virtues to a contrary sense. For I mistook her patience for simplicity, her kindness for wantonness, her thrift for covetousness, her obedience for flattery, her retired life for dull stupidity. And what with the grief to think how ill I used her, and grieving to see how ill this wife uses me, wasting my honor and estate, she hath brought me into a consumption, as you see. But when I am dead, for I cannot live long, I desire you, who are my executor, to let me buried in the same tomb wherein my loved wife is laid. For it is a joy to me to think that my dust shall be mixed with her pure ashes. For I had rather be in the grave with my first wife than live in a throne with my second. But I grow very sick, even to death. Wherefore, let me be removed.
Son-in-law, did your brother say he was very ill?
He said he had such a pain on his left side as he could not sit on his horse, but must be forced to return home again.
Oh, bless him. My heart is so full of fears and doubts if it prognosticates some misfortune to me.
Pity, sir, be not so dejected, nor look so pale. I dare warrant you the news that his barb hath won the race will be sufficient cataplasm to take away his stitch.
Where is your lady?
In her chamber, I think, sir.
Do not you know, and yet dwell in the same house?
No, indeed not I, sir, for I only saw my young master go towards my lady's lodging, but I did not follow to inquire after their health, for fear they should be angry and think me bold.
What do you but think, sir? Do you not know? Mrs. Sun, you wait not very diligently.
Why, sir, I met my young master going towards sister's chamber, and he sent me on an errand, and when I came back, the outer doors were locked, so as I could not get in any ways.
The door is locked, you say?
Yes, sir.
Oh, let them be broken open, oh, servants.
My doubts will tell a miserable tragedy.
Yes! Let go!
This is so strange an accident that hardly story can mention the like.
I wonder how they came to be murdered, the doors being locked and opened themselves. If it were thieves, they would have robbed as well as murdered them.
I think my young master was the thief that did both rob and murder.
Would I could tell a story that I had, listening one day at my lady's chamber door. But I will not.
Pretty tell it us.
No, I will not. You shall excuse me for this time.